Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Billy Ball, Billy Martin and the Resurrection of the Oakland A's by Dale Tafoya, narrated by Barry Abrams. If Billy goes, only he himself will go. The things he has left here, they will remain. Mike Norris, 1980. Forward by Ken Korak. I might have been the only person who enjoyed the Oakland A's slip down into the abyss in the late 1970s. They drew only 306,000 fans in 1979 and lost close to 110 games. But that was great with me. I was searching for a job in broadcasting, but didn't have a tape to send out. The Oakland Coliseum was the perfect place, since I could have whole sections to myself. I'd sit down the left field line in total solitude, and that's how I made the play-by-play tape that helped me get my first job. None of this would have been possible just a year later, because Billy Martin was on the scene, and a rebirth was taking place. Billy Ball brought more than just credibility and hope to a once moribund franchise. Yes, Martin was cantankerous and flammable, but even as a manager, he was must-see entertainment. He was also brilliant and dynamic, and there was the anticipation that with Billy at the helm, anything could happen. And with the A's, beginning in 1980, that meant that the Coliseum was now home to an exciting brand of baseball played by a team that mirrored Billy's personality. It didn't hurt that Billy Martin was a local kid who had prepped in nearby Berkeley before debuting with the Yankees in 1950. It also didn't hurt that the team's young core featured another local, the dashing Ricky Henderson, who at 21 was setting out on a career that would take him to Cooperstown. 1980 was a building block year, as the A's won 83 games and stunned the baseball establishment with a starting rotation that combined for 94 complete games. As Dale Tafoya beautifully chronicles in this book, the 1981 season was one of the most seminal in baseball history. New ownership took over the club, two legends were now in the broadcast booth, but Billy was still in the dugout, and the Coliseum, once dubbed the Mausoleum, was the place to be. After returning home from an undefeated trip that began the season, the A's christened the new era before 50,000 fans at the home opener and walloped the Seattle Mariners 16-1. Long after the final out had been recorded, Bill King sat alone in the broadcast booth, enjoying the quiet and reflecting on what he had just chronicled. Soon, A's president Roy Eisenhardt joined him, and as they sat together, they talked about how everything in their world seemed perfect. As Bill later told broadcaster Marty Lurie, Roy's eyes were just glistening as he looked out onto the field and reflected on a 9th consecutive victory. The sprinklers had been turned on, the grass was green, and it seemed the sky was the limit for that A's ball club. And indeed, with a talented team often driven to success by the mere force of Billy Martin's will, the A's would make the playoffs in 1981. And even in a strike-interrupted season, they drew 1.3 million fans, a million more than they drew just 2 years earlier, and the most since moving to Oakland in 1968. I broadcast my first minor league season in 1981 and had plenty of time once the season ended to visit the Coliseum in September. I was blown away. It was like magic. The sound system, the new look of the scoreboards, the energy in the park, the quality of the team on the field. Just walking into the ballpark, it all felt divine. This short forward is a mere snippet of what happened in Oakland once Billy Martin took over the club. Dale's writing, his attention to detail, and the insight that comes from a lifetime of following the A's gives listeners a fascinating account of one of the greatest eras in the history of one of baseball's storied franchises. Anyone watching the A's play in three straight World Series beginning in 1988 wouldn't have likely remembered how close the A's were to moving a decade earlier. As Dale tells the story, a transformation had taken place, with Billy Martin at the center of everything. Prologue. Finley's last manager. It was the merger of an owner who has been trying to get out of baseball and a manager who repeatedly has been thrown out of baseball, and it is an effort to pick up the pieces of a sick franchise. Dave Nightingale, Chicago Tribune, February 22, 1980. February 21, 1980. It was a union of convenience for two of the most controversial figures in Major League Baseball. Billy Martin, baseball's fiery gunslinger of a manager, flew to Chicago, not Oakland, for that Thursday's 3 p.m. presser. Inside an eighth-floor suite at the Drake Hotel in Chicago, 61-year-old Charles Oscar Finley, the Oakland Athletics' colorful owner, introduced the firebrand Martin, the franchise shaker with drawing power, as his new manager. Billy was Finley's 15th different manager in 20 years. On the eve of spring training, the A's were scrambling to mount a competitive season in Oakland. For years, uncertainty had clouded the once celebrated franchise, and the future of Oakland A's baseball was bleak. Major League Baseball's new financial structure, free agency, allowed veteran players to shop their services at the expiration of their contracts to the highest bidder. Introduced as the result of an independent arbitrator's decision in 1975, free agency was, in effect, forcing Finley to sell his club, the one he moved to Oakland from Kansas City in 1968. Finley had brought three straight World Series titles to Oakland from 1972 to 74, but he'd lost his stars to wealthier owners and slashed payroll in half, keeping the franchise alive on a shoestring. Some wondered why Martin took the job. At any rate, if any franchise needed saving, the A's fit the bill. Attendance at A's games was so bad that many baseball owners, along with American League president Lee McPhail, wanted to take the team off life support in Oakland and move it elsewhere. Many were convinced that the San Francisco Bay Area could only support one major league club, the San Francisco Giants, who arrived there first in 1958. The A's nadir was reached at a chilly home game on April 17, 1979, when a tiny crowd of 653 was announced. Some witnesses have insisted that figure was generous, estimating that only about 250 people were there. "I probably knew everybody sitting in the stands," chuckled Jeff Newman, the A's starting catcher that night. And only 1,215 fans showed up the next day. Alienated fans, resigned to the fact that the team would likely be moving, lost interest, and stopped showing up. Drawing only 306,763 fans in 1979, the A's were hemorrhaging money, averaging only 3,787 fans for each home game. American League clubs traveling to Oakland rarely met budget. Earning the nickname the Triple A's and Oakland Pathetics, the last place A's lost 108 games in 1979. Trying to hit on a winning formula, the A's shuffled managers and broadcasters every year. The falloff reached the point where a local college radio station broadcasted their games in 1978. Behind the scenes, Finley had, since 1977, been trying to reach a deal for the sale of the team to wealthy, Colorado-based oil magnate Marvin Davis. Davis planned to take the A's to Denver. Finley had been embroiled in a costly divorce and finally reached a settlement in January 1980. Among other benefits for the A's owner, the settlement ended an order that any sale of the A's needed court approval. The family was ready to sell. Finley dropped his $200 California business license, and the A's cleaned out their offices 4 days later, leaving everyone in the dark about the A's future in Oakland. In fact, McPhail had delayed printing the 1980 schedule because of the A's limbo. Oakland officials, just 11 days before the press conference, had rejected a $4 million buyout proposal from Finley, Davis, the American League, and San Francisco Giants owner Bob Lurie that would have released the A's to Denver and announced there would be another A's season in Oakland in 1980. Davis's efforts to bring the A's to Denver had tanked one last time. The A's instability forced such updates for anyone who cared. In 1979, the city of Oakland and Alameda County had sued Finley for not promoting the club in the community. Oakland A's baseball in 1980 was up in the air, in the hands of a conglomerate of local political forces, including the Oakland Raiders, and engulfed in litigation. Shackling the A's to Oakland was a 20-year ironclad lease agreement that Finley signed with Oakland officials in 1967. Under its terms, Finley's A's were essentially stuck in Oakland until 1987 unless local officials freed them from their lease. Also part of this backdrop was Oakland Raiders owner Al Davis, who was eyeing a larger market down south and threatening a possible move to Los Angeles. 51-year-old Billy, who signed a 2-year contract worth $250,000, showed up in the thick of this uncertainty. He'd been fired by New York Yankees owner George Steinbrenner the previous October following a fight with a marshmallow salesman in Minnesota. It was the fifth time in 11 years that Martin had either been fired or forced to resign. The A's were a moribund franchise in need of a boost the aggressive Martin could provide. But Martin, who was born in nearby Berkeley, needed some hometown cooking. Returning home to manage the A's meant Billy could reunite with his 78-year-old mother, Joan Downey, and focus on his health after a few turbulent years in New York. His main goal was to bring excitement back to Oakland A's baseball. "I think I can get the fans to come back in Oakland," Martin assured the press. "They like exciting baseball, and that's my style of managing. I'm happy to be here. Charlie made me a wonderful offer, and I'm pleased with the opportunity to keep baseball in Oakland, which is my hometown." Billy had been a part of Oakland baseball championship lore in the past. In 1948, starring for Casey Stengel's Oakland Oaks, he helped lead them to their first Pacific Coast League title since 1927, sparking civic pride in the community. After an 11-year career as a major league player, Billy managed his first big league club, the Minnesota Twins, in 1969. He went on to manage the Detroit Tigers, Texas Rangers, and in 1975, the Yankees. Martin brought wins and excitement wherever he managed, but he also had a tendency to cause trouble, which eventually led to his dismissal. Although he warred with front offices, fans, particularly working-class fans, adored him. "He was the most fascinating manager and, in a baseball sense, the best manager I've ever covered," said Bruce Jenkins, longtime columnist for the San Francisco Chronicle. Finley had flirted with bringing Billy on board as manager intermittently since the A's were in Kansas City in the 1960s and Martin was coaching in Minnesota, but they never joined forces. Finley admired Martin's baseball acumen and knew he could fill the stands despite his pugnacious reputation. Martin's hiring was announced a day before A's pitchers and catchers were scheduled to report to spring training in Scottsdale, Arizona. Finley had decided only a week before not to bring back Jim Marshall, his former manager, opening the door for Billy. Desperate to generate excitement in order to attract a buyer for his club, Finley turned to the unemployed Martin because Billy had a reputation for conquering fan apathy and hypnotizing players into believing they could win. He'd done it in Minnesota, Detroit, and Texas, and he'd taken the 1977 Yankees to a World Series championship. He seemed to have a formula for bringing baseball fever to a city from scratch. The declining A's were the perfect landing spot after Martin's unceremonious exit from New York. Billy was the epitome of what the A's had been in the past, said Steve McCaddy, one of Billy's former A's pitchers. That was Billy growing up. He wasn't the best player, but he fought his way through it. He was the perfect fit for our organization. The A's in 1980 were like a desperately ill patient in need of a bold physician, a miracle cure, and a good deal of hope. Billy Martin was the doctor, and what came to be known as Billy Ball was the remedy. 1. The Triple A's. It was a catastrophe. We were basically a Triple A ball club until Billy Martin got there. We didn't really feel like a big league team at that point. Mike Norris, former A's starting pitcher, August 2018. In 1977, Oakland was baseball's version of Alcatraz, the island prison located not far away in San Francisco Bay. Players were sentenced there. The A's home field, the desolate Oakland Alameda County Coliseum, an empty, drab, concrete mausoleum constructed for football, reminded some players of a prison yard. Only the contrasting A's uniform colors of Kelly Green and California Gold slightly brightened up the concrete dungeon in front of crowds that averaged just 6,100. Alienated fans had lost interest. When 23-year-old Bob Lacey trotted onto the field, what few fans there were could still see the ghost image of fingers on the back of his uniform. The A's tall, rookie lefty reliever had just arrived in Oakland after the club promoted him from the San Jose Missions of the Pacific Coast League on May 12th. Frank Sienchik, the A's equipment manager, handed Lacey the old uniform jersey of the club's former all-star closer, Raleigh Fingers, number 34. Lacey, standing at 6'5" and weighing about 190 pounds, had a similar body size to Fingers. Fingers' old jersey was available because he had left the A's to sign with the San Diego Padres during the inaugural free agency carnival in 1976. Lacey's teammates chuckled when they saw him hop out of the dugout with Fingers' old uniform. That was a sign of the times for Oakland A's baseball in the late 1970s. Uniforms were recycled. New managers were the only fresh commodities on the A's unpredictable conveyor belt of skippers. Charlie Finley, the 59-year-old maverick owner of the A's who brought three world championships to Oakland from 1972 to 74, didn't purchase new uniforms often in 1977. The A's owner, once heralded as the Barnum and Bailey of the baseball world for the revolutionary ideas he introduced to the game, was notoriously cheap. He scrutinized laundry bill after laundry bill and grilled Sienchik on why 10 uniforms were washed when only 9 players played in the game. "He was so cheap that he wouldn't even buy new uniforms," said Bob Lacey, who pitched for the A's from 1977 to 80. "We had to use the same stuff." Finley's parsimony had other drawbacks. For example, A's batting practice was unconventional for a major league team. Finley never bought new bats for spring training. Therefore, players were forced to use leftover bats from the previous season. There were only about 24 balls to hit, so players rounded up the balls after they hit them. And while many teams analyzed game tape as part of their training and preparation, the A's lacked video equipment. So players who wanted to watch a recording of a game had to visit a local restaurant. Finley, a Chicago insurance tycoon, operated with a conviction that if he felt it wasn't necessary, he wouldn't buy it. Finley and his A's were in transition and declining fast. The window had closed for the A's glorious run of 3 consecutive world championships and 5 consecutive division titles from 1971 to 75. The honeymoon in Oakland was over. Free agency, which allowed players to test the market for their services, was forcing Finley out of the business. He was spending the bare minimum to keep his operation alive in Oakland until he found a buyer. The limbo made playing in Oakland unattractive. Ball players don't perform in Oakland, they do time. Most of them spend their idle hours plotting an escape. Most of the talented A's, the Reggie Jacksons and the Joe Rudys, managed to go over the wall. Left behind were the lame, the halt, and the blind, wrote Paul Oberjergy of the Gannett News Service in 1980. Finley was plotting an escape himself. The unraveling began on December 16, 1974, when arbitrator Peter Seitz ruled that Finley violated the contract of his prized ace, Jim Catfish Hunter. The 28-year-old Hunter, baseball's premier pitcher, was coming off another celebrated championship season. He won the American League Cy Young Award in 1974 by a virtue of a 25-12 record and stingy 2.49 ERA. But Finley had failed to pay Hunter half of his annual $100,000 salary in the form of deferred payments to a North Carolina-based insurance firm as agreed to in their contract. Hunter's dismay over what he considered Finley's breach of contract was leaked to the media. At the time, Finley claimed the payment language confused him. Under pressure from Commissioner Bowie Kuhn, Finley offered to pay Hunter the $50,000 in a lump sum. But it was too late. Since the contract stipulated that Finley must make annuity payments, and since Finley failed to do so, Seitz voided Hunter's 2-year contract and declared him the first free agent in baseball's modern era. The ruling sent shockwaves around the league. Hunter, who'd tossed a perfect game for the A's in 1968, was a free man and could render his services to the highest bidding club. Hunter was the first star of the celebrated A's dynasty to bolt. But initially, upon learning of the arbitrator's ruling, the pitcher was nervous.
"I hung up the phone, turned to my wife and said, 'We don't belong to anybody.' I was scared. I didn't have a job. I didn't realize the implications."
He needn't have worried. After a major bidding war for Hunter's services ensued, he signed a 5-year, $3.7 million contract with the New York Yankees on New Year's Eve, making him baseball's highest-paid player. Hunter also received a $1 million signing bonus.
"He really liked his teammates and playing in Oakland, but he didn't like the lying and scheming that came from Finley," recalled George "Doc" Medich, who was Hunter's roommate in New York in 1975. "He was very happy to get out of there."
Hunter's historic deal set a precedent for future free agent salaries and foreshadowed what was to come when star players came up for bid. His departure was a harsh sign of things to come for Finley and his soon-to-be folding dynasty. The Major League Baseball Players Association was getting stronger under the negotiating muscle of Marvin Miller, the executive director, and players were finally gaining independence. The business of baseball was changing fast. It threatened Finley's ownership model. Finley's worst nightmare came true in 1976. Thanks to continued adept negotiating by Miller, and prompted by the case of Dodgers pitcher Andy Messersmith, baseball's reserve clause was effectively wiped out. Free agency was introduced and allowed players with at least 6 years in the major leagues to shop their services to the highest bidding team. For the first time, players now had options and leverage. Baseball's richest owners could attract the best players, placing modest spending owners like Finley at a disadvantage. Finley was a master talent evaluator,
but free agency loosened his control of players. It shifted the power to the players and wealthiest owners, and would inevitably cost Finley his best talent and weaken his club. It didn't take long for the ruling to have an effect on Oakland baseball. 8 of the 25 players on Finley's A's roster would test the market after the 1976 season. One of Finley's strategies was to receive compensation in return for them before they walked. His biggest fear was receiving nothing for them. Free agency forced Finley to adjust to the idea of locking up players to long-term deals. In 1977, Stan Bonson, a 32-year-old A's pitcher, inked a 4-year deal with Finley worth $500,000, the longest contract Finley ever awarded a player. Bonson remembered how free agency changed how Finley offered him a contract. "If it weren't for free agency, he wouldn't have offered me more than a 1-year contract. That's why he was so against free agency. He knew he couldn't afford it, and we weren't drawing a lot of fans. I don't think Finley could really afford free agency." Finley, seeing the writing on the wall, had already shipped a pair of all-stars, slugger Reggie Jackson and starting pitcher Ken Holtzman, to the Baltimore Orioles for Don Baylor, Paul Mitchell, and Mike Torres on April 2nd, a week before the 1976 season. Then on June 15, 1976, in what was called a Tuesday night massacre, Finley stunned baseball by selling 3 of his superstars for $3.5 million. He sold 3-time 20-game winner Vida Blue to the Yankees for $1.5 million and Fingers and Rudy to the Red Sox for $1 million each. The sales would have dramatically impacted the balance of power in the American League. 2 days later, however, Major League Baseball Commissioner Bowie Kuhn voided both sales in order to maintain competitive balance, which he deemed in the best interest of baseball. Blue, Fingers, and Rudy returned to the A's, and a furious Finley began suing and battling Kuhn, with litigation continuing into the following season. The race for the exits in Oakland became official during baseball's first free agent draft in November 1976, when a bunch of A's talent jumped ship. Fingers and catcher Gene Tennis signed with the San Diego Padres. Third baseman and team captain Sal Bando signed with the Milwaukee Brewers. Rudy and another outfielder, Don Baylor, joined the California Angels. And shortstop Bert Campaneris inked a deal with the Texas Rangers. In a short period of time, Finley lost premier talent and received nothing in return. What a difference a decade had made! In 1967, he'd moved the A's from Kansas City to Oakland with its population of 400,000 and close proximity to 4 million others with easy freeway access. Many had encouraged Finley to consider moving the A's to Seattle, but he insisted on Oakland, even though the Giants of the National League had already occupied the San Francisco Bay Area since 1958. "He wanted the bigger market in the Bay Area," said John Hickey, former A's beat writer for the Oakland Tribune. "He figured it was better to be the second team in a huge market than the first team in a smaller market." Finley was also intrigued by Oakland's newly constructed, spectacular $25 million Oakland Alameda County Coliseum, which opened in 1966 on 140 acres of land, and featured a 3-tiered 50,000-seat stadium and 16,000-seat indoor arena joined by an exhibit hall in the center. The Oakland Raiders of the American Football League were already tenants. The Coliseum also featured 4 removal wedges of seats to convert the stadium from football to baseball. At the time, it was considered a groundbreaking multi-purpose entertainment complex, and marketed as a launching pad for East Bay greatness. The Nimitz Freeway, which ran alongside the Coliseum, provided quick and easy access from the neighboring cities. Studies conducted in Oakland had forecast a population of 6 million within an hour's drive by 1970 and 8.8 million by 1990.
The A's drew 50,164 fans on opening night in 1968 for their inaugural season in Oakland, but only 5,304 showed up the next night. After Finley's stars left, he watched his franchise decline in Oakland from his South Michigan Avenue insurance office in Chicago. Rumors of Finley selling the A's were common. There was a lot of negative publicity coming out about the A's organization, with Finley wanting to sell and move them, said Dave Haverlow, a former A's reliever who was acquired by the A's in a trade that sent Blue to the Giants on March 15, 1978. I had heard he was getting rid of everyone. I began to realize quickly how dysfunctional the organization was. It was disheartening. The once star-studded swingin' A's had become a stripped-down product of Finley's contempt for free agency and his railing against the establishment. By 1977, only Vida Blue and Billy North from the A's championship clubs remained on the team. Blue's teammates nicknamed him the Captive because Finley held him prisoner. Writers started calling them the Oakland Apathetics, Awful A's, and Triple A's. We were a bad team, remembered Steve Dunning, who pitched for the A's in 1977. It wasn't the best of situations from a player's perspective. Finley was pretty much controlling everything. Our manager, Bobby Winkles, didn't have any control or authority to do anything. I don't know if Finley made out the lineup and pitching rotation, but everything was mostly pre-approved by him. Former A's pitcher Steve McCaddy, who signed as an undrafted amateur free agent in 1973, remembered the circus of player turnover in the late 1970s. We were like the island of misfit toys, said McCaddy. There was a rotation of different players coming in and out. We were in the minors, and he was bringing in these guys who had done nothing in the big leagues. We weren't getting a chance, and it became a little frustrating. You were always getting pushed back by these older guys. There were numerous signs of a franchise in decline. World Series trophies earned in the early 70s were used in the A's office to file mail and stationery in between the trophy flagpoles. Former A's catcher Jim Essien described calling the A's offices one winter only to get a message that the phone was disconnected. Finley was demanding that A's players turn in any half-fare airline coupons they collected on team flights. Finley had given Oakland three straight World Series championships, but he stripped that team, said Dave Newhouse, longtime sports columnist for the Oakland Tribune. There was nobody in the front office except for his cousin Carl and MC Hammer, Stanley Burrell Jr. The fare served up by the A's in the Coliseum press box was Kentucky Fried Chicken. The University of California's 10-watt student radio station, KALX-FM, broadcasted A's games in 1978. 20-year-old student Larry Bear, the chief executive officer of the Giants today, was the A's play-by-play voice. None of the Bay Area radio stations were interested in carrying the A's. The A's instability scared them away. Judge Eddie Saper, Billy Martin's longtime friend and legal advisor, said the A's cupboards were bare when they arrived in 1980. They didn't even have a copy machine. When we got there, Lee McPhail, the American League president, told me, "We have major league standards for these owners, and you might find the A's a little short when you arrive to spring training. If you need the cooperation of our office, we will get you everything you need to meet our standards." Because fans weren't showing up at the gate, the A's became a financial drain for the American League as a whole. Clubs were losing money traveling to Oakland. "It's a good idea to get out of the Bay Area because it's been costing us money every time we go to Oakland," Calvin Griffith, former owner of the Minnesota Twins, said in 1977. "We don't meet our expenses when we go to play the A's." As the A's tumbled badly in the standings, Finley ran a conveyor belt for managers. After Dick Williams resigned following the 1973 season, Finley ran through managers Alvin Dark, Chuck Tanner, Jack McKeon, and Bobby Winkles, from 1974 to 78. In June 1977, Finley fired Jack McKeon and replaced him with Winkles, a coach for the Giants who had previously coached in Oakland under Dark and had captured championships on the collegiate level at Arizona State. But the following season, in 1978, Winkles, fed up with Finley's meddling, quit on May 23rd after leading the A's into first place with a 24-15 record. Winkles once explained to BeachwoodReporter.com why he resigned. "I just couldn't take his crap anymore. I'd be up every morning at 6 o'clock. When you're the manager, you get home at 12 or 12:30 every night. At 2 o'clock, he's calling, 'Why didn't you do this? Why didn't you run that guy?' We're leading the league by 2 games. So I said, 'Well, I'm going to quit on top. Now's the time. I'm going to do it.'" Jeff Newman, a former catcher who played for the A's from 1976 to 82, remembered when Winkles called it quits. "We saw papers announcing his resignation on our chairs when we walked in," recalled Newman. "Winkles was exceptionally nice, but he couldn't deal with Charlie anymore, and I could understand that. Winkles was on the phone a lot in the dugout, and everyone knew he was talking to Charlie." Finley replaced Winkles with McKeon, his third base coach, whom he'd fired as manager the previous season. "Standing here, I feel as secure as the manager of the Oakland A's," Willie Mays joked during a Dean Martin TV roast in 1977. "When I arrived in Oakland in 1977, I noticed that the place was being run on a shoestring," remembered Medich. "It just didn't have the touches the more mature and better-funded franchises had. We flew only one charter flight during the season I was there. I remember the chaos the most. We had players coming and going all season. I don't know how many people were on the big league roster that season, but there were a whole bunch. We never knew who would be in the clubhouse the next day." The 1977 A's finished in last place in the American League West with a 63-98 record, and while the 1978 club got off to a sizzling 19-5 start, they ended up 69-93, only finishing ahead of the last-placed second-year Seattle Mariners. "The struggle was always to avoid losing 100 games," said Hickey. "They were so overmatched." Mike Norris refused to carry the team luggage sporting the A's logo during road trips. He was embarrassed. "It was a catastrophe," said Norris, who pitched parts of 10 seasons for the A's. "We were basically a AAA ball club until Billy got there. We really didn't feel like a big league team at that point. Other than McKeon, we didn't have any major league managers. Winkles had just come out of Arizona State and didn't know how to treat us like men because he was transitioning from working with college kids. So that didn't go over too well with us, and Marshall wasn't a major league manager, period. We didn't have a proven major league manager." Finley offered Rene Latchman the A's managerial job in 1979. Latchman, who had deep roots in the franchise, had been a manager in the A's organization from 1973 to 77 and helped schedule spring training workouts for farm director Norm Koselke. He signed as an 18-year-old catcher with the Kansas City A's in 1963. Latchman flew to Chicago in severe snowy conditions to meet with Finley about the managerial vacancy. "He told me that if I turned it down, I need a psychiatrist," Latchman said. 2 days later, I called him and asked if he knew any numbers to any psychiatrists. Latchman declined the offer. He was concerned about Finley meddling with his lineups. Finley ended up choosing Jim Marshall to manage the 1979 A's. Latchman went back to managing the Mariners' AAA affiliate in Spokane. Attendance was so bad that A's reliever Dave Haberlow volunteered to shave his head if the A's drew 40,000 fans. By 1979, the A's hit rock bottom in the stands and on the field. On April 17th, the A's announced a crowd of 653 on a freezing, gloomy, windy, and locally televised night game against the Mariners. Insiders claimed that was a generous estimate, however. An unofficial census of players, coaches, security, press, ushers, and others who earn a living at the game totaled 223, wrote Tom Weir, an A's beat writer who covered the game for the Oakland Tribune. Considering there are 9 more A's home games to be televised, the fans may get outnumbered by the workers before this season is over. The late Herb Kane, former columnist for the San Francisco Chronicle, got into the act. "The A's drew 653 fans Tuesday night," he wrote. "Can you name them?" Newman remembered the nasty weather and historically tiny crowd on that chilly night at the Oakland Coliseum. "I probably knew everybody sitting in the stands," chuckled Newman. "Charlie just didn't make it a very enjoyable experience for the fans to come out at that point. We weren't the best team, but it was still the big leagues. He had alienated the people in Oakland by always telling them he was going to move the club." The A's finished the 1979 season in last place with a record of 54-108, the worst in franchise history since Connie Mack's Philadelphia A's were 36-117 in 1916. A's attendance stayed embarrassingly low, drawing 495,599 in 1977, 526,999 in 78, and 306,763 in 79. The season attendance in 1979 was the lowest since they arrived in Oakland and lowest in franchise history since the Philadelphia A's drew 304,666 in 1954, their final season there before relocating to Kansas City. From 1977 to 79, the A's combined attendance was 1,329,361. Across the bay, the Giants alone drew 1,456,402 in 1979, while the Dodgers led the pack that year with a season attendance of 2,860,954. Even the expansion Mariners outdrew the A's in 1979, with a season total of 844,447. "The attendance was unbelievably bad," remembered Bruce Jenkins, a longtime Bay Area columnist. "The teams were terrible, and they were on a treadmill to nowhere. As long as Finley was in charge of the club, having dismantled what was one of the greatest teams of all time, it seemed like he had given up at that point." Finley was fielding expansion-like teams in the late 1970s and drafted and acquired some talent that began showing up in Oakland. He drafted prep standout Ricky Henderson, who played locally at Oakland Technical High School in the fourth round in 1976. Henderson sparked the A's during his debut in 1979 and was on his way to superstardom. Finley had also drafted center fielder and soon-to-be-captain Dwayne Murphy, third baseman Wayne Gross, and outfielder Mike Davis. Pitcher Rick Langford, along with talented hitting prospects Mitchell Page and Tony Armas, came from Pittsburgh in a blockbuster trade that Finley authored before the 1977 season. Toiling in the minors were a group of young A's hurlers, Mike Norris, Brian Kingman, Steve McCaddy, and Matt Keough, a former shortstop who converted to a pitcher in 1976. Norris, the A's first-round draft selection in 1973, and heralded as Catfish Hunter's heir apparent, was struggling and battling nagging arm issues through the minors. On June 15, 1979, the A's acquired 24-year-old catcher Mike Heath, infielder Dave Chalk, and Cash from the Texas Rangers in exchange for lefty starting pitcher John Henry Johnson. The A's already had Jeff Newman and Jim Essien, two established catchers, so Heath played outfield most of the time for the remainder of the season. "We were a bunch of young guys ready to pop and needed a no-nonsense manager to make us believe in ourselves," said Heath, who played for the A's until 1985.
These were the Oakland A's of boomboxes, gold jewelry, and swagger. The endless shuffling of the A's roster and player turnover kept players on their toes. No one was safe. Infielder Rodney Scott got the message quickly when he came to the A's in a trade from the Rangers for Claudel Washington in the spring of 1977. "We never knew what was going to happen on a daily basis," said Scott. Scott remembered flying out to right field to lead off a game against the Brewers at Milwaukee's County Stadium on June 22, 1977. He trotted back inside the dugout to grab his glove to play shortstop, but before he could get on the field, Rob Picciolo had taken over at short. A's manager Bobby Winkles had taken Scott out of the game in the first inning without telling him. Since Winkles removed him from the game so early, Scott figured he would shower early and wait for the game to end in the clubhouse. But after Winkles saw Scott walking toward the clubhouse, he directed Scott to the A's bullpen to warm up pitchers. Scott told Winkles that he wasn't a catcher, so he wasn't going to warm up pitchers. Winkles warned Scott that there would be consequences if he refused to report to the bullpen. Scott reported to the bullpen. Teammate Billy North stuck up for Scott, but Finley later confirmed that as long as he's paying a player, the organization could assign him wherever they wanted. "I had never seen that before and was not accustomed to that treatment," said Scott. "That made me realize anything goes here. It was pretty wild." It was wild in the air, too. The A's rarely flew charter planes. They flew commercial flights that stopped in several towns before landing in the next city they were playing in. Finley didn't usually pay for charter flights. Medich remembered the club being caught in a vicious thunderstorm one night as they flew on a Boeing 737 to Kansas City to play the Royals for a four-game series in September 1977. Medich was just celebrating Finley placing him on waivers so he could escape Oakland. The thunderstorm was so ferocious that everyone thought they were going down. "This happened right after he finally put me on waivers," said Medich. "I was finally getting away from Finley, but I was going to die in Kansas first. I saw Dorothy and Toto fly by six times." The pilot finally made an emergency landing at a tiny airport in Salina, Kansas, which was a five-hour drive from Kansas City. After being stuck for 5 hours at the tiny airport, the team bussed to Kansas City from there. "We looked like clowns stuck at that airport," said Medich. "The farmers arrived to catch a plane, and they looked at us like we were the circus in town." Stan Bonson remembered the traveling nightmares that came with playing for the Thrifty A's. He said that while most teams flew to the next city directly after getaway games, the A's flew commercial the next morning on game day to avoid paying lodging the night before. "It was inconvenient and giving other teams an edge over us because of how we traveled," said Bonson. "After we played a night game in Oakland, if we had to play in Chicago or New York the next day, we'd have to get up early in the morning and fly all day. When we finally got to the hotel, we had to report to the ballpark for the game. That's the way he did things. I remember arriving in Milwaukee at 5 p.m. once for a 7:30 p.m. game." Bonson was shocked one day when they arrived at Burbank Airport after playing the Angels and a rare charter flight back to Oakland was waiting for them on the runway. "When we started boarding the plane, I was wondering why the flight attendants were seating us on the back of the plane," said Bonson. "We found out cargo was stored in the front half of the plane. We were on a cargo plane. Are you kidding me? I'm sure it was discounted." Most major league clubs employed at least 30 front office staff at that time, but Finley had only six. "He was great with players in the early part," said Latchman. "If you'd get called up, he'd give you money for clothes. He'd send you beautiful Christmas presents. But free agency killed him." The A's depended on the Major League Scouting Bureau to select players from the amateur draft. The A's didn't have any scouts, so they scouted and drafted by phone. Finley once had a stable of 20 to 25 scouts, but when the Scouting Bureau began centralizing and computerizing intelligence on prospects in 1974, he dismantled his scouting department and relied on their information, although most teams used the Bureau service as an option. "He was trying to get out of baseball, and he wasn't going to put anything into it," said Latchman. Believe it or not, the farm system wasn't that bad. Late legendary scout Dick Winsick, whom Billy Martin brought over to revitalize the A's scouting department in 1980 when he took over as manager, recalled the disaster he inherited when he arrived. "When we first took over there, we didn't have any scouts, and our minor league teams were bankrupt," Winsick said in 2004. "The place was left a mess. We didn't even have any forms, so we had to start from scratch." Everyone wondered how the A's drab situation would end. "I kind of felt bad for Charlie because only a few years before, he knew he was going to lose a bunch of stars to free agency, and he was trying to get money for them, but Kuhn negated all the deals. I didn't think that was right," said Medich, who finally escaped and joined the Mariners in September. Many baseball insiders concluded that moving the A's from Oakland was the only solution to save the franchise. But moving the A's out of Oakland wasn't so simple. 2. Baseball's Boat People. The A's lease is a strong, valid contract, which we fully intend to enforce. We shall make every effort to assist the A's in making baseball a success in Oakland. Lionel Wilson, former mayor, Oakland, 1978. On December 14, 1977, Colorado-based oil millionaire Marvin Davis announced that he had purchased the Oakland A's from Finley and the team would be playing at Mile High Stadium in Denver for the 1978 season. The bombshell generated national headlines. The insatiable Davis was a wealthy Colorado real estate developer who'd made his fortune as CEO of the Davis Oil Company, the world's largest independent oil company. He was believed to be one of the wealthiest men in America and was touted as being as rich as Greek shipping mogul Aristotle Onassis, the second husband of Jackie Kennedy. Davis was the real deal and walked in powerful circles. He moved millions of dollars for a living and rubbed shoulders with the likes of then-President Gerald Ford and former Secretary of State Henry Kissinger. He flew on his private Gulfstream G2 plane and lived in a 33,000-square-foot mansion in the luxurious Cherry Hills Village, south of Denver. He was also very private and preferred not to discuss his wealth. Finley knew Davis had deep pockets and was serious about bringing the A's to Denver. Finley, during his failed courtship of Renee Latchman to manage his 1979 club, apprised him about Davis. "He told me he was going to sell the club to Marvin Davis, a millionaire oil man in Colorado," said Latchman, who was serving as a minor league manager in the A's organization. "He said Davis had enough money to buy all the clubs in the American League. He said he would sign me for $45,000, and if Davis decided to get rid of me, he'd put a stipulation in my contract that he would have to pay me $100,000 to get rid of me." The 52-year-old Davis agreed to purchase the franchise from Finley for $12.5 million, including a $5 million deposit. Finley had purchased the team in Kansas City for $4 million in 1960. Denver would be the A's fourth home since 1954. Nancy Finley, the daughter.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.